This show was previously broadcast live on ProgressiveRadioNetwork.com. Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, and I'd like to welcome you to a special presentation. This is part two of a three-part series based upon in-depth original investigations by individual experts, people who I have looked carefully at the evidence and are agreeing that the official 9/11 story, the official report given by the government, is inaccurate. Why? That's what we're exploring. We're not making a claim. We're simply putting together pieces of this puzzle. Each person we've spoken to thus far, a two-hour special yesterday, and what will be whatever it takes today, an hour, hour and a half, or 2 hours. We've set time aside. There'll be no rushing this. In fact, we're going to examine this with the same type of methodical scholarship, a sense of reason, a probing exploration that any scholar or group of scholars would do if they really want to know the truth. Unfortunately, the American public are no longer naive enough to believe everything that comes out of official reports. Two of my guests today, Erik Lawyer, who will be on the second part, is a veteran firefighter with the City of Seattle and founder of Firefighters for 9/11 Truth, a non-partisan group of firefighters who demand reinvestigating the official 9/11 stories for the benefit of all the rescue workers who suffered injury and illness and died. He continues to be a full-time fireman with over 20 years in emergency services. But my first guest is Richard Gage. Richard is a San Francisco-based architect and member of the American Institute of Architects. With over 20 years of experience, he's an expert in fireproofing and construction of tall high-rise structures. 5 years after 9/11, he founded Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. They now have approximately 1,100 architects on board who challenged the official report about the causes behind the tower's collapse. Now, we should note that Richard's organization does not blame any particular individuals or groups for the 9/11 attacks. Rather, they represent the science and physics that show the buildings could not have gone into free fall due to the impact of the planes, and rather there needed to be additional demolitions. Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth released a periodic newsletter, The Blueprint, to anyone interested. And there's where we begin our discussion today. Nice to have you with us today, Richard Gage.
Thank you very much, Gary. It's an honor to be here.
Richard, we're going to begin with the obvious, and from there we will expand. I've already informed the public yesterday that we are going to try as much as possible to stick with hard science, objective information. However, it is not possible to discuss this without also allowing individuals an opportunity to put forth hypotheses. It's for the audience to realize that these are a person's own personal opinions and may or may not be relevant to the issue. For example, yesterday we found out that there were thermitic, non-exploded and exploded debris in the dust that was collected at the site, that the government has refused to do any testing on this or even to test the idea of how did this get there. These are not materials, combustibles, that could burn at 4,500 degrees Fahrenheit that are part of normal building materials. You don't build a skyscraper with these highly volatile chemicals in your mix. You just don't. Nor is it in the steel. So how did they get there? That's a reasonable question to ask. The government has chosen not to explore that. Also, if this material, approximately 3,000 tons, was in the structures, and it would have been in all three structures, how did it get there? Who placed it? This wouldn't have been a lone individual. It certainly wouldn't have been any of the Al-Qaeda individuals, because they wouldn't have had access. So it would have required someone who had plausible deniability, had access, and knew that there was going to be a cover-up. Then it begs a more simple question. What would have been the motives for people to have done this? Now, they would have had to have coordinated, knowing there were going to be jetliner hijackings and which buildings they were going to be flown into, in order for them in advance to have gathered their group together, planned a demolition at the time of the planes hitting the towers, and they would have had to have known in advance that the hijackers had planned this. That's a no-brainer. So that meant that there would have had to have been people with access to the highest levels of intelligence within our intelligence agencies who decided that something needed to be done, whatever their ultimate motives. So unless we start tying all these pieces together, it doesn't make sense to the average American. We all know this. We know that two planes went into the World Trade Towers. We know that a third building, building number 7, collapsed and did not have a plane go into it. And no one has really given us an explanation of how did this building really collapse when there was no major fire, there was no highly incendiary device in the building. There were witnesses in the building who claim that they heard explosions when the building collapsed. And yet none of this has been dealt with in any official investigation concerning Building 7, at least. So I'm hoping that you will give us your opinion and then support what you can with fact. So that's what my intent is with our interview. So let's go to it now. Now, yesterday we had Professor Jones and Professor Herrett discussing the material of the demolitions. Can you speak best on the architectural structure of the towers in Building 7 and compare the architectural science and evidence with the official report that the buildings collapsed due to the fire starting from the planes hitting the buildings?
Sure. So we'll start with the Twin Towers and then we'll move over to Building 7. Does that sound like a good plan?
Yeah, that's a good plan.
Okay. Well, I represent now over 1,100 architects and engineers who are staking their licenses, their degrees, their reputations on not conspiracy theory, but science-based forensic evidence found at the crime scene that you have already highlighted in your and in your course in your interview with yesterday with Dr. Jones and Dr. Herrett. These architects and engineers are extremely concerned about what they did not know, did not hear about in the last 9 years from the mainstream media and from the official reports, the NIST report, National Institute for Standards and Technology, the FEMA report, and certainly the 9/11 Commission report, which didn't even mention the third worst structural failure in modern history, that of the 47-story skyscraper Building 7, which we'll get into later. When these architects look again at the Twin Towers, what we see is fires, which in the case, fires inspired by the, fueled by the jet fuel, and the plane impacts, of course, had somewhat significant impact and causative factor on the collapse of these buildings, according to the official story. But the entire NIST report takes us only up to the initiation of collapse. All of the analysis that they had done stops at the moment the building begins to become unstable. They acknowledge this, and they also acknowledge that they do not have a full explanation as to how the towers collapsed, much less at near free fall acceleration. So let's start with the fires. In the case of the South Tower, those fires were going out, and there's limited flames. There's plenty of reports from the firefighters and the radio communications that are recorded that these fires were small and isolated pockets here and there. And yet an hour after the plane hit, the building becomes completely unstable. So let's talk about what happens there. But never before in the history of skyscrapers have fires caused the collapse of a skyscraper. These are